All right, welcome back. We continue to await Bruce Boudreau. What could be a very interesting and emotional news conference coming up from Rogers Arena. We do have after hours coming up with Louie and Scott and Kirk McLean in just a matter of moments. Let's just put a quick bow on that. We're going to send it out, but I just want to say thank you so much. Hockey Day in Canada is a special day here at Hockey Night in Canada, and it's been 14 and a half hours of coverage. Special thank you to Owen Sound, incredible host for the 23rd annual Scotiabank Hockey Day in Canada. Without further delay, let's get you out there. Scott Oake, Louie DeBrusk, Kirk McLean at Rogers Arena. It's after hours. Scott.
David, thank you very much. Hockey Day in Canada is an appropriate time to remember a great Canadian success story. The Vancouver Canucks, their fans, in fact, the entire hockey world, I would suggest, was rocked this week with the news of the passing of Gino Odjick at the age of 52. Few players have ever connected with their city the way Odjick did with Vancouver and with Indigenous communities across the country. And so Louis and I are happy to have with us tonight Kirk McLean, a Canucks ambassador and teammate of Gino Odjick for his entire time as a Canuck from 1990 to 1998, during which time, Kirk, the chant Gino, Gino, mm-hmm. echoed throughout the Pacific Coliseum in this building, and it spoke to his deep connection with Vancouver. You had a front row seat for it. You saw how it unfolded. How did Gino Odjick become a legend?
Well, I think the way he played, obviously, the way he expressed himself on the ice, which was by any means possible to land a spot in the lineup, and we all know what he could do with his fists.
Unfortunately, firsthand, I know too well.
Yeah. We're going to see it in a few minutes too. Yeah.
But his physical play and just the way he he stood up for his teammates.
I think it's fair to say that Gino initially won the hearts of Vancouver fans because of his role as an enforcer, and the role was different back then. There were more of them, and any player who regularly stood up for his teammates was destined to become the most popular guy in town. And so, Kirk, you had been with the Canucks for 2 years when Gino played his first game here, I think, November 21st of 1990. In the third period of a 4-1 win over Chicago, he fought two of the toughest customers in the NHL. Mm. First of all, Dave Manson, and then Stu Grimson.
Yeah.
What were you thinking about the raw rookie during this game?
Well, I think I was still thinking why he was wearing number 66.
Yeah.
But he wore that for not too long. But there you go. I mean, two tough customers you talked about. But that was Gino, and he was a willing combatant that was going to take on anybody and everybody.
And he makes everybody bigger, right?
100%.
Like, as soon as he jumped on board there, you guys were already a big team, by the way, but all of a sudden, you're a couple inches bigger with Gino.
Myself included, in the back end, and that's, you're 100% right. I mean, that was the role of the enforcer back there, to make everybody else feel at ease, especially the superstars or the talented players on your team, the smaller players, if you will, as well. And guys like Cliffy, and of course, we all know his special friendship that he made with Pavel.
Gino Odjick had about 150 scraps as a Vancouver Canuck, one of them on December the 3rd, 1992, by which time he had established himself as a legitimate NHL heavyweight. And Louis DeBrusk was in the process of doing the same. Let's watch.
You see DeBrusk backing off near the blue line there. Now here they go. DeBrusk and Odjick, two number 29s. Drop the glove.
Okay. What were you guys talking about?
You know what? Pat Quinn put him out there. Ted Green put me on the ice, and all of a sudden the fans started to go crazy, and Gino jumped on the ice, and we just knew right away, and he came up and said, yep, let's do this. And yeah, I might have taken a few on the top of the head in that one. He was a very tough individual, very hard to fight. I had some battles with him, but he was always that guy. I'll say this, he was the first guy that ever fought in the NHL, bumped into him a bar in Edmonton, because our first fight was in Edmonton, and bought me a beer.
Yeah.
So let's have a beer, let's have a chat. And it really, for me, was, made me realize this is a job.
Yep.
When you get off the ice, he was just a great human being, and chatted, went his way. And
yeah,
I went,
a very honest player. He once in a while he would lose it out there, as we all do, but like you said, he knew his role, and you knew your role. I'd hate to be that person to have that role, the night before games, thinking about what needs to be done the next day. In the case of his first game, he's got Manson and Grimson. You know, he knows he's probably going to have to fight both of them and hopefully come out okay. And he did. And, you know, I would never want to have that job. No chance.
Jason Strudwick sent me a message, his story of his encounter with Gino. He said, I was traded for Gino and played each other the next night after he said he didn't mind being traded but didn't like being traded for a nobody. Jason said, my ego was pissed, so I decided we were going to fight. We did fight, and I felt better. A year later, we saw each other, and he apologized for saying that. He said he was just emotional. It was a great moment between us. Yeah. That's the kind of guy he was.
Yeah.
Well, let's be clear on something. Gino Odjick was more than an enforcer to his teammates.
Mm-hmm.
That may have been how the love affair started, but it quickly went beyond all of that. And we're going to hear from a number of his former teammates tonight. Here is Gary Volk.
Yeah, myself and Gino, we broke into the NHL within a week of each other. We were rookies together. We were roommates together. We go back so far, and he's definitely going to be missed. But one of the things I loved about him, and I always remember him as a hockey player, was not just his fighting. Obviously, he was brave and he was tough. He could do that. But how much skill he had, how he got better each and every year. I played a lot of games on the same line with him, and I'll never forget Gino because he wanted the puck. He wanted to score. Nobody loved scoring more than him. And his biggest thing every day in practice was opening up for a one-timer. Hey, Valky, I'm open. One-timer, one-timer. He'd scream all the way down the ice, and I'd feed him, and he scored. Tremendously skilled as well as tough. So that's what I remember most about Gino. As a hockey player, as a human being, man, we laughed a lot. One-timers, maybe the funniest guy I've ever played with. He could take a joke. You could bug him. He wouldn't care. He'd give it right back. Very witty and a great teammate to have for my 3 years here in Vancouver.
Louis.
Yeah, great stuff. Well, talk about that. He really did work on his game a lot. And when he got bumped up and started playing with Pavel, started to score goals, he had 16 one year. That was a real eye-opener for people around the league that realized, hey, this guy can play. He's a force out there. He's big. How was it for you in practice with him working on shots and the one-timers that Gary was talking about there?
As a goaltender back then, one-timers we didn't like, right? But there was a guy, if he was going to take a one-timer, you weren't going to come at him chopping your stick like you would everybody else because he'd get right back to you, obviously. But Gary was 100% right. That was one of the things I was really proud about, what he turned himself into, was a complete player, not just the fisticuff. Yes, that may have set the tone for giving him a little bit of room out there because people knew what he could do, and having Pavel beside him, you know, working on things in practice after practice on a shot as one timer, whatever it may be. And you're right, he scored 16 goals 1 year.
And that was 93-94, the year of the run to the cup final. And he often played up in the lineup, most often with the Russian Rocket, Pavel Bure. What do you recall, Kirk, about the best advice that Bure would give Gino Odjick?
Pretty much as he probably would tell everybody, but it would just go to the net, put your stick down, and wait for the pass. And direct it in, you know, simple things like that. And, you know, Pavel had a great sense of humor as well and does have a great sense of humor. And those two, they were inseparable. And they fed off of each other.
I think we've got some video of them together here.
Yeah, I mean, always smiles. Every time you see them together, laughing and joking. But there you go right there, a little tip shot. Working on his eye-hand coordination. Billy Ranford's wondering what the hell is going on there.
Yeah, no chance on that one.
I can't believe I just let him score on me. Yeah, there you go.
And how did that friendship develop between him and Pavel?
You know what? I think Gino just realized, okay, here's our superstar, and this is the guy that I'm going to have to look out for. And
there you go. Get to the post, and I'll get the puck to you.
Yeah, I'll get it to you. You know, it's kind of like what McDavid does for everybody out in the ice today. But he worked on it, and bless his heart, you know, he didn't want to just be that tough guy and that role player. He wanted to be able to get out there in certain situations and be accountable.
Here's Gino in the year 2003 at an event that both he and Pavel Bure attended, and he touches on his relationship with the Russian Rocket.
I'm real happy Pavel made it here. I know in 1993-94 when I scored 16 goals, I know there was a lot of Russian in me. But in the playoffs, when Pavel knocked out Shane Sherlock-Holt, there was a lot of Indian in him.
Yeah, boy. That was an elbow to the head by Brewery on Shane Sherlock that knocked Sherlock
I think
clear
out Pavel
game two of the Western
suspended.
Conference.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it was a vicious hit.
Yeah.
All right, let's hear from Pavel Brewery.
Gino Odjick was more than a hockey player. He was a kind soul. He was a strong leader. He loved the community, and he loved the Vancouver Canucks. He was also my dearest friend. I would like to send my heartfelt condolences to Gino's family, friends, and community. While I deeply mourn his passing, I can't help but put a smile in thinking of how touched Gino would be to witness this outpouring of support from the Vancouver community. Thank you, Vancouver. Gino Love.
Do you remember, Kirk, the classic story of Odjick trying to find Brewery in Moscow?
Vaguely. We were talking about this the other night when we were having our little celebration for Gino. I think it was Ronnie DeLorme that was telling me that Gino was going to Russia for a charity game.
Right.
And,
against Red Army.
Against the Red Army. And he didn't get picked up. Was it Fetisov that was supposed to send him a car to be picked up, and it didn't show? So Gino remembered that Pavel told him once, if he's ever in Russia and he can't get a hold of me, go to the KGB.
Yeah, the KGB knows everything in my country, was what he told
him. And he did.
Yeah.
He went to the KGB, and they found Pavel for him.
Wow. Two guys with machine guns answer at the door, and about 15 minutes later, he was in Bure's company.
Yeah.
Bure and Odjick were inseparable, although every Vancouver Canuck, it seemed, benefited from Gino Ojic's friendship. Mm-hmm. Here is Jeff Courtnell.
Gino Odjick, an amazing guy, great teammate, biggest heart of anybody I ever played with, came to win every night. Stuck up for all his teammates. He was just an amazing guy. And probably the greatest memory I have of him is he loved to score. He worked hard in practice to try to improve his game. And the night here in Calgary when he scored on the penalty shot, I mean, the place and the city went crazy. So it was pretty exciting.
Yes, the penalty shot, October of 91, with the Canucks leading the Flames 3-2 in the third period. And, Kirk, you were either in the opposite net or on the bench. I'm not sure which, but what was your view of this?
Well, I mean, it shows you how important it was for what it meant for Gino, you know, to score a goal early in his career there. And, of course, against the Mike Vernon and a big-time rival, the Calgary Flames. And he made it look kind of easy there, I must say. Sorry, Vernie, if you're watching, but, you know, look at that reaction and the reaction of the fans, and of course the guys on the bench were so happy for him.
Well, Jeff Courtnell was right. The roof blew off the place, and you know, which celebration made it look like he had just scored the winning goal in the Stanley Cup final in overtime.
Yeah, it looks like that was Jimmy Sanlak, I think, that was up on the bench cheering him on.
I love that reaction from the guys, too. They were pumped for him.
Yeah,
that's awesome. You guys were pumped for him.
As you know, I mean, when you have fan favorites and guys that you're rooting for on your team all the time to do well, and something like that happens, you can't help it but be happy for them and show emotion like that.
Gino Odjick's career with the Vancouver Canucks ended in March of 98 when he was traded to the Islanders, and about a month earlier, Trevor Linden had been sent to the same team. So let's hear now from the former Canucks captain and team president.
I think can't think about Gino without a big smile coming on my face. I think the one little-known fact people forget, and I almost forgot myself, is that we were teammates in New York for the Islanders. I got traded on February 6th. He got traded about a month later, and it was the end of the year. We were out of the playoffs, and we were rooming together on the road, and we both kind of played the night before, both tired, got up, and Gino looked at me, and he called me Dutch. He was the only player to ever call me Dutch. He called me Dutch because my dad was from Holland, so he said, Dutch, I don't know what's going on. I don't even know why we're here right now. And it just made me laugh. And he just had, I think he's the kind of guy that brought a smile to our faces. And he was a great teammate. He was extremely loyal, cared about people. And that's why he's loved in Vancouver.
Well, our thanks then to Dutch Linden. Mm, yeah. Although it doesn't sound the same if it's not coming from Gino Odjick. Did Odjick have a name for you, a nickname for you?
No, I don't think he did. Not that I can remember. I think he just called me Mac, you know, basically, at the end of the day. But, you know, if he did, I didn't hear it. And whatever it would have been, I'm sure it was pretty funny if he was telling it to other people. But, you know, so ironic, you know, when we're talking about this, you know, about how great he was. And, you know, he had so much heart. And then he dies of a heart condition, you know. It's so sad.
Yeah. I've always had this feeling with tough guys and goaltenders. They have a unique bond because it's a very unique position, especially back in the day. Mm-hmm. I got along with my goaltenders tremendously because they had an isolated job. Tough guy was a job that a lot of guys couldn't relate to that weren't doing that role. Did you kind of have that same bond with him? Did you have that connection?
Yeah, you know, and with my defensemen as well, because most of the guys I played on in defense were, in the early years, were tough. You know, we had the Dave Richters, we had the Glenn Cochrans and Garth Butchers and, you know, players like that. So I could relate, yes. I mean, it's a tough job to have, as a goaltender is. And you know, if we could talk to each other and feed off of each other, that was something that we would always try to do. And you know, Gino was really good with all of his teammates, as you've been hearing, and there's not much more you can say about it. He was just a wonderful human being and just an awesome teammate, and the community obviously loved him, and just completely in touch with his own community and the indigenous community.
Well, how beloved was Gino Odjick? Consider this, 16 years after he played his last game as a Canuck in 2014, he was diagnosed with a terminal heart disease. It causes a hardening of the heart, and at the time, Odjick was given anywhere from weeks or months to live, and about 200 people showed up at Vancouver General Hospital in a beautiful show of love and support for Gino.
You mean a lot to us. Yeah.
Thanks, man.
Yeah. You mean
love
a lot.
You, Gino.
You mean everything to us.
Love you.
On a couple of occasions after that hospitalization, he fought off what could have been fatal bouts of the heart disease. So it was a beautiful thing when he was able to be part of the Canucks' 50th anniversary celebrations in January of 20.
In his first game as a Vancouver Canuck, he established himself as a fan favorite. Fiercely loyal, his teammates became and remain his brothers. His friendship with the Canucks' most exciting player enabled the Russian rocket to launch. A man of great compassion and courage, Gino Odjick.
It doesn't show up as much here. You could hear the Gino chants in the crowd, and it was great to see that ovation that he got coming to the center ice.
I could tell you, him doing what he's doing there took a lot of strength by Gino, and it was unbelievable to see him do that. And I know for a fact there's no way he was going to miss that. And the one thing about his condition, you know, going back to when it first happened in 2014, I remember it was yesterday, because I believe Yerky Lumi and myself were the first two to go in to see him. We didn't get a chance to talk to him. He was sleeping at the time. And then about a week later or so, or half a week later, about 15, 20 of us went. We thought that was going to be the end. So we were all going in to say goodbye, and then we saw the video, you know, what took place after that. And, you know, he came to almost every game he was here. He came to pretty much every alumni event. He didn't complain. He didn't moan or groan. He enjoyed himself. He was the Gino we knew. You know, he always had a smile. He was always telling jokes. He was always, you know, needling people, you know, and that was just the way he was. I mean, he just a strong warrior.
All right. The greatest part of Gino Odjick's legacy, obviously his profound effect and his commitment to Indigenous kids all over the country. In the video we showed you earlier of Gino Odjick fighting first Dave Manson and then Stu Grimson, he was wearing number 66, but he soon changed to number 29. And Louie, you can tell us why.
Yeah, it's an amazing story. His dad, Joe, at age 9, was sent to a residential school in Spanish Ontario, and his registration number was number 29, and Gino, in honor of his father, wore the number 29, and he was very proud of his heritage. And I played with Gino later in my career in the American Hockey League, and we had discussions about it, and you know, for me, I just think he was just such a great example for anybody, but for especially Indigenous people, to show them the way. This is how you can get it done. This is what you can do. But he always had that connection with his people, and rightfully so. He was really proud of that.
Gino Odjick was a full-blooded Algonquin from the Kitty and Zibi First Nation, not far from Maniwaki, Quebec. He didn't start playing organized hockey until he was 11, and then up until the age of 15, only with reserve teams, at which point Bob Hartley, who went on to coach 14 years in the NHL, recruited Gino to play with the Hawkesbury Hawks of the Ontario Junior League. Hawkesbury is about 3 hours away from Kitty and Zibi, where Gino Odjick obviously had become a hero and a mentor, and it goes without saying that that First Nation was crestfallen with the news of Odjick's passing.
We're shocked. I'll be honest, it's a shocking moment for Kitty on Zibi. We're mourning. It's a sad day here.
Gino was a gentleman all around. And as far as he got, the most humble person you can meet. Didn't speak much, but when he did, you know, everybody respected him. Everybody loved him. He's a family man. Respected throughout our community, respected throughout our town, and obviously with the name Gino Odjick on the arena. Gino was a true friend and loved everyone. You know, Gino remained a fighter through his hockey years and after.
But it wasn't just Kitty and Zibi where Odjick's influence was felt. It was in First Nations communities across the country. Going back to as far as 1995, Odjick took on what was called a journey of healing between Calgary and Vancouver, and he stopped in 14 communities along the way to create awareness over the pitfalls of alcohol and drugs. Odjick would spend his entire adult life mentoring Indigenous youth. Upon his retirement from the game in 2002, Gino and his best friend, Peter Leach, would visit three or four Indigenous communities per month, conducting seminars that usually were sports-related but quickly evolved into education. So there are countless kids, Indigenous kids, across the country who can claim to have been positively affected by Gino Odjick, and Ethan Bear of the Vancouver Canucks is one. Ethan Bear now with Dan Murphy.
Scott, thank you. There's been a lot said about Gino Odjick the last few days, Ethan, but I'm going to ask you this. Him as a player and as a person, what did he mean to the Indigenous community?
He's an inspiration, a role model, a leader, trailblazer. He did a lot of things for Indigenous people, and to make the NHL at that time, it was probably, it's a lot harder than it was back then that it was for me now. You definitely have to break barriers, but Gino did it with a smile, and he did it with a big heart, and he's a great teammate and a great leader. So, he's done so much for the Canucks and Vancouver as a community, he left his heart on his sleeves when he played the game, and he's definitely somebody that. I was lucky to talk to when I came here, and he's definitely somebody that a lot of people could look up to and just thankful for the work he did.
And we should tell you the Canucks will host a celebration of Gino Odjick's life prior to their game against Minnesota on March the 2nd here in conjunction with the club's first annual Indigenous Night. How appropriate. Gino Odjick, gone too soon, but he's left the world a better place, forever remembered, always loved. Kirk, thanks for being with us tonight. Thank you, Louie.
My pleasure.
We'll return to Rogers Arena in a moment, and when we come back, we'll hear from Canucks coach Bruce Boudreau, who we believe coached his final game in Vancouver tonight. Rogers Arena, the Oilers beat the Canucks here tonight. The dying moments of the game, Bruce Boudreau's final game, we believe, behind the Vancouver bench.
Describe the emotions you're going through right now.
This might be a long press conference if I do that. It's... You never know if it's the end. So when you've been in it for almost 50 years, the majority of your life, and if it's the end, it's, I had to stay out there and just look at the crowd and just try to say, okay, remember this moment type thing. I've never had it where, I was fired once in the middle of the season. And by the way, they haven't fired me yet. Just but George called me to his house, and we had a long talk, and then that was it. It's different when you get a chance to say goodbye to the players, and they're emotional, and I'm emotional, and it'll obviously be something that stays with me for my whole life. And I mean, I've had a couple people like me in the past, but not the way the fans have been treated me. It's just, city's amazing.
Bruce, do you have a message for the fans after?
No, I just thank you. Like, I mean, I don't know what I did to deserve it, but I mean, I'm glad they, last year, like I said, the there it is chant, I was a little worried, for the players, but it sure felt good, obviously, yesterday and today. I just wish we could have won one for them.
Did you talk to the group right after?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. How hard was that?
I didn't make it through far, I can tell you that. So, and then they all came into my room individually just now, so, which made it even harder. So.
What do you make of the push that they gave in the third?
Oh, they tried their heart out. I mean, I think last night was a little, like Tyler said, it was knowing it's the end type thing, but tonight they played their ass off for me, and the other coaches, and because I don't know the status of, we don't know any of the status of who's going, who's staying. I'm sure that's going to come down relatively soon. So they played hard, and I can't ask, as a coach, you can't ask for any more than the players laying it on the line for you. So, and the texts and in the last 2 days and the calls have been more than I ever thought.
Bruce Boudreau, understandably emotional, but he goes out with his head held high and with the admiration of Canuck fans. Back to conclude proceedings at Rogers Arena. Day night hockey, it's the Islanders at Toronto, and that does it for this edition of After Hours. On a night, Vancouver Canuck fans bid farewell to Bruce Boudreau. And again, our thanks to Kirk McLean for joining us to remember Gino Odjick tonight, and thanks to Odjick's teammates who sent messages. Thanks for watching tonight, and good night from Vancouver.